Hey, the dog got food.
Okay.
Okay. Hey, very good.
How are you?
I'm good. You look gorgeous. Look at you.
Oh, well, thanks. I'm actually halfway in pajamas, but
nobody sees that.
Nobody can see that, right? You look amazing.
Wonderful.
But you're in New York now, right?
Yeah, I'm in New York. That is my kind of my I can see an Ash studio. So you can see all kinds of things on the table. There are no portraits. In the mirror, you can see animals. And on that back wall, you can see portraits on the, which are in frames.
Beautiful.
This is here.
Yep, and I see the gentleman behind you. I mean, it looks good, yep.
That gentleman behind me is my dad.
That's your father. Wow. Oh, that's beautiful. I'm glad you are able to do that. I think you're doing an amazing job, sister.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So happy to hear that. So we basically don't have to. Let me just run my hot water that I can have that is a little bit loud so that I can have a tea. I have prepared everything. And basically, we don't have to discuss anything. I will just, I thought I introduce Icons in Ash, and then before I ask if anybody has questions, I will introduce you. What would you like me to say? Or shall I, why don't I just let you introduce you yourself? And you can exactly say what you want.
I really don't have, you know, it's up to you. I really don't want to steal any of your thunder. I'm just here really to support you and encourage and be your cheerleader. So I, you know, if you want, I will say, you know,
mm-hmm.
I'm Sabrina and I learned about this product and it's not really a product. It's really a service. And I think that it's a tremendous thing that you're offering. So, you know, and it's a very unique way to celebrate a life, and I will just kind of piggyback and say I think it's going to work in my bereavement center. So if anybody has influence in their community to offer your services, I think that they should definitely. So that's kind of the approach I'm going to take.
That sounds absolutely wonderful.
Okay, well, good.
Is there anything you would like me to anything you would like me to do or say or not forget or whatever?
No, I mean, this is really your show and I'm just here to support you. So like I can share my vision, you know, like how this is going to work in our community. And really I'm just, you know, my goal is just to be a soundboard for you. And if anybody, you know, they want to order directly through your website. And if they say, well, what does it look like in Texas? Then I can certainly say, hey, this is a great idea. And, you know, if those questions do arise, then I will gladly help you answer those. There's nothing really from my end. I'm just here to, like I said, support you.
Okay. Then I think I switch my video off for 2 minutes and then we will be on.
Okay. I'll see you in a bit.
Okay, wonderful. Hello, welcome everybody. This is an event hosted by Reimagine End of Life, and they suggested to start every meeting with a festival statement to set a tone or consistency of experience through all virtual events. There's no life without death, no love without loss. They are in constant complementary motion, but never before in our lives has the world stood still, so still. In the face of distance, illness, and isolation, we are here together, reimagining a changed world. Kinder, slower, more just. We are reimagining the giving and receiving of love, the cycles of loss and new beginnings, and what it means to be fully alive. We are here. So I just wanted to do that as a setting of tone, but also because I'm really thankful that Reimagine gives us the opportunity to talk about death. And I think it's a very important thing. So I'm Heide Hartree. I'm an artist. I'm represented by Ubu Gallery in New York City. And I have started to make something what has to do with death. I realized actually that when I looked at my work, all my work had to do with death, not only this recent one. And that might have to do with my upbringing, because I was brought up on a factory farming pig farm, and there was everything surrounding me had to do with death, because we had thousands of pigs which we fed, and then when they were big enough, we killed them. And there's, beside that, there's also a lot of other death going on. And I guess my work was influenced by that. But in why I actually started with Icons in Ash was when one of my closest friends died in 2008. He committed suicide, and I was completely out of my mind. I was shocked because I didn't expect that. And then something really weird happened, the death of my father, who was, which was, in my opinion, also a suicide, but rather claimed to be to have been an accident, came kind of forcefully back, and I was not really functioning. And I had this sudden idea to make portraits out of the cremated remains. It sounds maybe like an absurd idea, but 3 weeks before my friend died, I was invited by a friend. He had lost his wife, and he has an urn on the mantel place, and allowed me to look into the urn, to actually see the ashes for the first time in my life, and it was completely shocking. It was like the whole life of a person in this jar, and I felt deeply touched. And I was working at that time at a project where I made portraits, but I made them out of wax, and I wanted to have a life-like portrait as possible. I wanted really to capture life, not only as Renaissance artists did, but in a way that you really can see through the skin, everything what is underneath of the skin, what we see when we see a real person. It is not a flat color. It is a very, very colorful thing you see when you look at skin. And I thought, if I make several layers of wax and put pigments between these layers, then you can actually see through these layers, and you can see the real skin as in a human being. And it worked pretty well. I can actually show you a picture. I should see it in the mirror here. Don't know if you can see it, but that is a friend of mine whom I made with this wax, with this new wax technique. Is that visible at all? It's a little bit relief, so the nose is a little higher than the eyes. And I was working on that, and I had kind of tested with different pigments, and a few nights after my friend had died, or after I learned about the that he had died, I had this idea to combine these two things, to combine these wax paintings with ashes. And I tested it for about 6 months. I just thought it must be a way to do this. And I realized that ashes is not kind of one color. Most people imagine ashes as black, because that's what we know from burned wood, but it is actually only the bones, and the bones are mainly bright, but even the bone structure itself is different. So outside, the part is rather pretty bright, but the inside, these little I don't know how you call it in English, actually, these holes which are in a bone structure, that is rather dark. And then there are often pieces which are even more dark. And so I separated all these different shades of gray into separate areas, so that I could use these kind of different colors to work with. And I had the idea to insert them into the beeswax. It was actually, I tested to mix it, as I did before with the pigments. This didn't work, so I also wanted the effect I wanted is that you see actually only the ashes. So I found a technique to how to heat up the wax, which I put very flat on the surface, and then I took a scalpel, and on the tip of the scalpel, I put one tiny little piece of ashes and placed that into the wax. And I did that thousands and thousands of times until the entire face was completely full with different tiny pieces of ashes. And I loved it. And I had a very hard time these six months when I was working on it. I was crying a lot. I was yelling at them. I was angry. I was devastated. I was super sad. I felt guilty. It was a really hard time. And I thought this painstaking meditative process was what healed me, because after these 6 months, I was totally fine. And that was it. I was not going to continue with that as an art project or anything. But I had a friend who, he was actually an assistant back then, and he had lost his mother when he was 22, and at the time he was, I think, 24, and he was very unhappy. And he reminded me in his unhappiness very much of my unhappiness when I was going through that. So he asked me one day if I could make a portrait of his mother. And I was not happy about this question at all, because he was supposed to work for me, and he asked me to work basically for him. And it was a very long and intense work ahead of me, and I wasn't very interested in doing that. But one day he dared to come with the urn of his mother and just put it on the floor of my studio and said, "Whenever you have time, I would be really happy." And I was not going to do it, but I didn't send him back with the urn. So the urn was standing there, and the urn started to talk to me. Or I had the feeling I should do that. And after I did it, he was transformed. He texted me all the time how he feels his mother again, how he feels her presence, that he looks at her, and it was an absolutely beautiful picture, and that he feels her being there, and he talked to her and was really happy. And I thought, wow, if that works with somebody who is absolutely not involved in the making process, then the making process is not even the thing. It is not even the meditative phase I went through. It is actually the thing. It might be the case that matter matters, that there is something what is feelable. And I talked to other people about it. Some asked me to do it, and I did. And surprisingly, everybody who got this portrait felt exactly this way, that they felt some kind of presence, and they adored this picture so much. And it was a difference between what many people do to have a photograph on the mantelpiece, and next to the photograph, the urn with the ashes. I basically combined that. And at the time when you look at it, you look actually at the person, exactly how she looked like, but also it is her. It is what we have left of her. So when I realized that this works, that this seems to work not only for me, but for other people, even if I make it for them, I thought I need to find a technique how to make it that actually everybody who likes the idea can have it. Because these 6 months working on something, nobody can afford that. Even now, after I made a few, I reduced that period of time to 6 weeks. Still, a normal person cannot afford that. So I really wanted to do it, and and tried to figure out how to do it in a cheaper way. But in a way, and I'm an artist, and therefore the result is the most important thing for me, I wanted it to be absolutely beautiful and that you still have this feeling of the original technique. And it took me about 2 years and I have applied for a patent, and last week my lawyer called and said my patent was approved. And that means I offer now this other technique, and this is much more affordable. I think that is the most important thing. I would like to say one thing. I'm so fascinated by how the world works, how things happen. For example, the technique I first chose is a mosaic technique. You see that in Ravenna or in other places, there are little stones, green, yellow, blue, and whatever, and the whole roof is full with this, or ceiling is totally full with these stones, one next to the other, and what you see is Christ and the sun or whatever. So these little pieces of stones, these colorful pieces of stones, are used as pixels on a computer. And when I realized that I have this mosaic technique, I came across a definition of mosaic, and I really like that, because in this old story where Moses comes down from the hill, he has these two plates of the Ten Commandments, and he sees these people dancing around the golden calf, and he's really angry and throws it on the floor, and then he regrets it and picks it up and pieces it together. And piecing something together which was broken and make it whole again, that is the definition of mosaic. And I think that is just so nice that I by chance chose a technique which is so meaningful. I also like the idea that, also by chance, that I use beeswax. Beeswax is the thing a new bee develops, which holds life. And to have these ashes holding the kind of keeping it alive, or holding the dead person, but making it somewhat alive again. I like that very much too. So this is supposed to be a kind of consultation hour. That means everybody is allowed to ask questions. There is in all these Zoom meetings a chat area. When you look at the bottom, it says chat. If you would like to write a question in the chat, you are very welcome to do that. You can also unmute yourself and ask a question. You can also show your face if you would like to do that. And one person who is visible already is Sabrina Young. She is the director of Young's Daughters Funeral Home, sorry. And she's just building now a huge bereavement center. And when I learned about her, actually she found me, but then I checked her out. She is doing an amazing job. She has a huge program for people who are grieving, and you can take classes, all kinds of classes and wonderful things. And I'm completely enthusiastic about her approach to do her bereavement center and what is possible. And she's kind of a part of this death positive movement. She has understood that we have to talk about death, and that our relationship to death has to change. It is a part of life, and we have to deal with it, and not dealing with it as I did with my father. That is not a solution. It is a stupid way, and we all are used to this stupid way. We all are used to go to the phone and do an emergency call to the funeral home when the person died, instead of sitting with the person and staying with him or her and understanding what is going on and understanding something about the other person and about oneself. So I would like to welcome you, and maybe you can say something about your wonderful center and what you do.
Well, thank you, Heidi. I do appreciate the introduction. I think having a bereavement center is going to be a very new development, especially within the United States. We have some. I've toured before I came to the vision of having the bereavement center, and they were mostly just counseling centers. They were just licensed agents that would educate children through play or get them to talk about their experience of having the absence of the person. And so I realized that everybody goes through grief. As a funeral director, all of my past families, I would meet with them, and they were always doing something to help with their grief. And I said, well, if you're doing it, and I have another person over here doing it, why don't we just do those things together? So when I realized that, I told my husband, I said, that's it, sell everything. We got to make a bereavement center. And so it is a little bit smaller than the vision, just square footage wise, it's probably about 5,000 square foot, but the classes are going to be virtual hybrid. So you can come in and see them through Zoom, because some of the presenters aren't in our immediate area. So it will be hybrid. So those that are in other areas will be able to join. But what I found that was transformational for me when I found you, I said, oh my gosh, you are more than a product. Like bringing loved ones back in the home. You know, when I saw your products or your paintings and your mosaics, when I saw them, you had a beautiful exhibit at our in Houston at the Funeral Directors Museum. And when I saw that, I lit up with appreciation of your service, because when I saw that I can give that to our families, I mean, if you go back to the very beginning of time, above the fireplace, there was the, you know, patriarch or matriarch of the family, and it stood there because it meant something. And even though it wasn't just the painting, I think with today's evolution of your service, you can incorporate those cremated remains. And I mean, I knew that this is going to be something that people are going to want. This is going to be a healing endeavor as well, because some people don't get to say goodbye or even touch or feel their loved one because of it. It could be a traumatic experience. So I think giving them that touch, that feel back to those families and those that didn't get to actually physically touch, they can touch for the rest of their time being here on earth through your portraits and through your mosaics and 3D wax pictures. And I mean, your techniques are truly healing. And so hats off, sister, you are doing an amazing thing. And I want to help you be a voice to get people a service that they might not know exists, because I found you all the way in New York and I'm like, wow, this is amazing. So if anybody, my biggest thing is if anybody is out there and you have the ability to offer services to people that are grieving, this is one that is well worth the value of what she's doing. So that's just my little spiel I just wanted to share with everybody. But hey, Heidi, you're doing an amazing job. And I also discovered that you do pets. So if you want to talk about that too, because pet parents, we go and do, you know, they're much more, if not more than like children to most of us. So when you lose a pet, instead of just having them on an urn and a mantle, could you share what that looks like?
Yes. I was not expecting that we talk about cats, pets, but I do have something here. This is, for example, the cat of a wonderful friend of mine.
That's beautiful.
I'm not sure if you can see it so well, but I put it out of the frame so that you would be able to see the surface maybe a little bit better. Here.
Wow.
One.
I love it. I mean, because it, with grief, you can grieve humans, you can grieve pets. Some people, you know, I think grief comes in all different forms. Oh, look at that, it's beautiful. Absolutely.
I also have dogs, and I make it in two different sizes. So this is 5 by 7 inches. That is pretty small. And I also make it in large format. Let me see. And here also one which is in the box. It comes with. It is a kind of 3-inch deep shadow box. It's in the back. Unfortunately, it's difficult to see.
Beautiful. Oh yeah, we can see.
So I think it's a nice idea to have it in a box which is kind of sealed, and it is, you kind of have it in a container as an urn, but you can actually see the ashes, and you don't see them as they are normally in the urn, but kind of put in a just different order. So
well, I think that's beautiful. With grief, it expands so much. So whether it's pets or whether it's humans, or, you know, some grieve just the loss of different things that aren't even the loss of life. So I definitely think that you showcasing that is so important in this one, because it's for grief. So I appreciate you sharing that.
Thank you so much, Sabrina, for everything you said. And I appreciate so much what you are doing. And I think everybody who is in the funeral business should offer these things, and the world would change. I also wanted to say that this exhibition you mentioned, that was supposed to be over, but because of COVID, they have just expanded it, and it will at least be visible, and they reopened the museum until November 30th, but they don't know exactly if they will continue with that, or if they will if it will actually close in November. So everybody who is by chance somewhere in Houston, that is really a pretty nice show, and I'm very, very pleased, especially because the way they showcased it was in kind of little niches. So everybody has, who is not related to somebody else, has a kind of little niche, which means it is black in the back, and then it has a little walls coming out of the wall, which are also black, and you have this separation from the other pictures, so that you can kind of stand directly in front of one and be just with that person. And there are a few exceptions. For example, my art dealer, he had asked me to make his parents, and his parents, I made several couples. I made one for my art dealer, one for my art dealer's brother, and one couple for the exhibition. And these two are hanging in one of the separation part. And I wanted to say something else. Yeah, I just get a question there. How much cremated ashes do I use? If I say I can make so many, so I basically only need a handful, and that is enough for one portrait. So you can make probably 10 or 20 portraits of a person. 10 is easily done, or I have done 10 for a whole family, and everybody wanted a different picture. And I thought that was very, very nice. And I have also done something for a friend who wanted a picture for from his brother, for the family of his brother, but also for himself. So there are different options to do that. But I don't need much of the ashes. And here's another question: What can you do with the rest of the cremated ashes? Either you can do whatever you had originally planned to do, scatter it or keep it somewhere, or there are so many options now. You can put it underneath of a tree, and that is the food for the tree to grow better. You can shoot it in the universe. You can build a reef as a habitat for fish. You can make it in a diamond and keep it with you. You can tattoo it in your skin. I mean, there are so many options. And I obviously think that the option I'm offering is the most beautiful. I just think it's so, what I like about it, I think, is that it is a way we started out to memorialize our beloved ones. The reason why we even came up, we people, with making portraits is to remember somebody who has died. And in this tradition, to continue in this tradition, I feel like I'm kind of conserver of tradition and doing something what everybody understands. Not everybody understands jewelry or other things, but this is something everybody can relate to, as you've said before, with the patriarch in the apartment. I think that is something. And then somebody asks, how does it work? So if you have the ashes at home, or if you wanted, if you, for example, were a family from Sabrina, and you would do the cremation with Sabrina, then Sabrina would send me the ashes. And if you are private, I would just send you a mailing kit. And in the mailing kit, there are different bags, and you can, everything is exactly described and instructed how to do that. You fill the bag, you write down your name, you write everywhere down your name so that there cannot be any problem, and then you send it to me. There's also a little label in it which says cremated remains, and there's a label in it which is the right label to send cremated remains. And when I will receive it, we will talk about what picture we want to use. Actually, of course, what you want to use, because it's not my picture, but as an artist, I'm of course very much interested in having a wonderful result, meaning I would love to help you deciding which picture is the best. And for that, it is important that the mouth, for example, is closed or as close as possible, so that you don't feel like you're looking into somebody's body. And if you remember the portraits you saw in a museum, they are always with closed mouths, because that is a problem in transferring that in a way that it looks good, even though a photo with an open mouth can look good. And so we discuss that. You tell me which is the photo you like best, and if I think that is probably difficult to be a good result, I will get in touch with you and tell you. But it's of course your final decision what photo we will use or which image. And we have, I say that it's very important that you write down your name everywhere. There are two different bags, and on the envelope is also should also be your name. Just it is that there is no problem that anything gets mixed up. As soon as it comes to our place, we label it, and there must be somewhere the name, and we label it, and we keep it always separate from anything else, so there can be not anything mixed up. So, any question? Any thought? Anything?
How long is production? What is your typical production timing to once they mail you the cremated remains and receive your portraits back?
As soon as I have the remains, as soon as we discuss what picture is the best, it takes for the mosaic portrait about 6 weeks, and for the ash transfer portrait, it takes about 2 weeks.
You know, one thing that I just want to say is, even though maybe you have cremated remains and they're in your mantelpieces or they're hidden in the tops of your closets, this would be a good way to get them out of the closet and into your decor, or back into your life, as opposed to just being tucked away and dusted. So, you know, for instance, if your parents have passed away, like one of the parents, and their anniversary is coming up, or, you know, bringing that back, because especially around holidays.
Beautiful idea. I love that.
You know, especially around the holidays, everybody that is at the funeral home that typically has this experience, they'll say, well, what about your holiday traditions? Can we come and celebrate and host a vacant seat for a table for Thanksgiving? Well, you know, this would be perfect. Mm-hmm. Instead of having that vacant seat, you can do this service, so that way they are brought back into your traditions. They're brought back into your decor room where your family sits and meets. And, you know, I'm not saying have a whole host of all of your family members around, but I mean, if that's what you're into, by all means. But if you lose a parent, how transformational would it be is if, instead of just having a vacant seat, if they were actually present in this portrait, in this, you know, gift for your mother that may have lost your father, or vice versa. Or, you know, as someone becomes pregnant, it's very important that mothers, they don't forget that child, even if it's through a miscarriage, or even if it's through, you know, a loss. They always keep up with the birth dates. They always keep up with the anniversaries, you know, of what would be happening. They would be starting fifth grade. They'd be graduating high school today if it wasn't for that tragedy, right? So, I mean, taking something like that, that memory, and bringing it to actuality, it means so much for people. And this is why your service is just, I mean, top of the notch right here, because bringing that back out of people to be aware that they don't forget, that they don't have to hide on the shelf, that they don't have to do these things. When you hosted this in the grief, for grief, I mean, just thinking about how, if you have the best friend that has lost the child and they're still coping, and if they're never going to get over it, but you can help them through services like this. You can bring that to them and say, hey, you know, I would love that you have this favorite photo, because, you know, they keep posting it online. They keep posting it, or they keep sharing it, or they blew it up, or, you know, it's something that's on their cell phone on the front. You know, if you can capture that photo and ask them that you would like to do something like that for them, and you know it's their favorite one, get with Heidi, let her transform that grief for them, because I can't tell you how meaningful that would be for a mother. I can't tell you how meaningful it would be for a child who, especially brides. You know, in grief, I didn't get to have my father walk me down the aisle. I've been married for 14 years and we've never had a wedding because I don't have a dad to walk me down the aisle. And I don't want somebody else, you know, as much as I love the other men in my life, that was a reserved spot for my father. So now when I've discovered that, I think, could this be the opportunity that I would want to have a wedding to have my father space there with his cremated remains? And golly, that's just, you know, transformational. I think that would be tremendously healing for brides. So no matter where you are in your grief, no matter what your grief looks like, I think this is a tangible way of holding your grief.
It's beautiful. I mean, I didn't even think of doing that later, but probably there are many, many people who have their ashes stuck away or somewhere and don't even want to go there. For example, when my art dealer learned about it, he said, "Oh my God, I have these ashes of my parents in the closet, and I sometimes don't even dare to open the closet." And he was so happy about this idea to get them out of the closet. That was really beautiful. And what you just said, I totally love that.
Really. You know, and so when they're tucked away and they're collecting dust, what does that do for us? It creates shame. It creates, oh, I'm not really doing the best I could be doing for this life that has lived, right? And so we start getting down on ourselves. But if you can transform something that's, you know, hidden away or doesn't seek its purpose, you kind of just left it there. I think transforming it and giving it a resting place or giving it beauty or bringing it to life is going to be, I think your children need it. I think the grandkids need to see it. I think it's something that can, you know, celebrate your family and your lineage. Too many times, I mean, the photos nowadays, people don't even keep the photo albums up to date. So, I mean, doing something very simple and yet elegant in this demeanor is rewarding. And the grandchildren will say, wow, I would rather have this hanging in my house instead of this collected urn that has a stigma of being eerie or creepy, or why would I want that? Can't we just go bury it? I don't want to look at that. But if you give them something visual to look at, such as a painting or a mosaic or the variety of services you offer, I think that's a lot more accepting. I would rather hang my grandpa or somebody else that's in my family on my wall instead of just collecting the urns. So I definitely think your tribute is beautiful. So I can't say it enough because I just believe in it, you know?
It's so wonderful. It makes me so happy that when somebody gets it and you love it so much that makes me really, really happy. When you were talking about grandchildren, I was also asked how long these portraits last. And the mosaic portraits, they basically last forever because it's like just like a candle. If you the candle will collect dust and the dust will stick on it, and that's it. If you don't put it on a radiator or in the sun, it will just last forever. And that will be the same thing with the portraits. The new technique is made a little bit different, but it is, and I don't have much experience because I only started that. So I have no idea how long it lasts, but it lasts certainly as long as a normal art piece, and art lasts normally pretty long if you treat it as a normal artwork. And because it is in the glass box, there is no need to fear that something goes wrong or that it will be a problem. And it comes in this box. You can either just hang it on the wall, or you can also place, because the box is so thick, or so deep. You can also just place it on a pedestal or on the mantel place. You don't have to hang it.
So I'm curious if anybody in this group, have you done anything? You know, how do you think that this could be transformational for other people? I'm just trying to get an idea. If anybody would unmute to see how this would transform other people in your life circles.
It's okay. It's also a difficult question, I think.
Well, you know, the thing is within grief, I mean, there's so many stories that could lighten and be brought to the front through this. You know, I shared about having women that have lost children, and I think it would be transformational to hold on to their child, you know, through your art. I think having the brides, I think, there's got to be other grief scenarios, and I'm just curious what that would look like for other groups.
I can tell you a few things from people who received a portrait from me. For example, a woman, she is a piano player, and she is she has the portrait of her mother on the piano, and the piano is right. She has a big apartment, and in the room of the piano is also her bed. So when she gets up, she told me that the first thing she does is say good morning to her mother. And I think that's beautiful. And she claims that this start of the day has totally transformed her life between the time when she had died and the time when she received the portrait. Or I just made it was a very sad story. A woman said her daughter is going to die, and she would like to. She never wants her to be in an urn, so she wants me to get the ashes immediately, and then I have to make the portrait immediately. And she only wants to see her ashes in form of a portrait and not in the urn, because she said she was too sassy and too alive and too wonderful to be ever in a box. And I talked to this woman a lot and realized, which I didn't realize because I'm so unaware and stupid, or I don't know, but I had no idea how many children die and how many children die of cancer. And I was so shocked. Not only that, I mean, that is bad enough, but also to look at the life these children have when they are basically after the diagnosis, and the diagnosis is not going to, I mean, if they are diagnosed and told that they will die, this time between the diagnosis and the death, that is spent in hospitals, and it's really hard. You would think or hope that you could make these last years much fun and make sure that this child is super happy and would never be so happy in his entire life, gets everything what it wants, talk to him all the time, whatever. But in many cases, that is not the reality at all. They are alone in the hospital because the parents have to work. They get visits here and there. And then there are many people who have not much money and cannot even bring them every time they come something what would make them feel better. And I learned that there are these charities who help with this situation. For example, one is called Fight All Monsters, FAM, or Make a Wish. And at the beginning, when the mother told me that Haven was extremely interested in these charities, and that she asked people to donate something to these charities, I thought that was stupid. I thought it was much more important to support cancer research so that people would not even get sick. But there are so many people out there who are sick and who, so many children, and who have a horrible life. Not only that they are sick, but that they will die and never have something what they enjoy. I find that so, so depressing. And I decided then to give 20% of my proceeds to a charity, and either the people who buy the portrait, they decide which charity. I have researched them and found some which are giving most back to the people. And but there's also an option that people can choose their own. I have met also people who said my hospital was so amazing, and I want, and they have way of a charity organization they are connected to, and we want to support them, and then that is of course wonderful. And I wanted to say, because of this change of my approach, I found these 6 places which are really amazing. One's called Alex Lemonade Children's Hospitals, from St. Jude to others, and Make-A-Wish and FAM. And in order to make that very clear, I have also changed my website. And if anybody has other questions, the website is called iconsinash.com, and there you can find maybe other questions answered, or other testimonials, or whatever you might want to know. So if nobody would like to talk to us, then I would have also like to know how you learned about it, if you learned about it through Reimagine or through other sources. Oh, and maybe I can advertise a little bit for a place I came across and really like. It's called End of Life. It's a platform where Michael Hepp is trying to get as many people from the funeral industry together. So there are death doulas, there are people who do what I do, artists, there are normal funeral homes, there are alternative funeral homes, there's everybody. And I think that is a really nice place. And there's also, for example, Death Over Dinner, an organization which I really like, because they have made a kind of template how you can invite different people to your home, make a dinner, and talk about death, and that you are not feeling totally uneasy and don't know what to do. They have this kind of template where they walk you through a scenario, how you could do it, and give you kind of questions, or give you a setting, how that makes sense. So that is all on this EOL platform, and there you can find many answers to questions you might have. Okay, I think we can wrap it up then. And I thank you very much for your interest. And Sabrina, you were absolutely wonderful. Thank you. Really, really.
I thank you so much for hosting this, bringing awareness. I thank you for your service, making things transformational for people, giving them something tangible. And I think hats off to you. I'm so proud of your patent. I'm so proud of what you're doing. And thank you so much for hosting this and being a part of Reimagine.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And I wish you good luck for everything with your new center. And I hope that people understand what an amazing job you're doing. Okay. Have a beautiful evening. And thank you, everybody, for joining. and be safe. Don't get sloppy with the virus. Just use your things you have to use and try to not get too depressed. Okay, bye-bye. Thank you very much.